This is Whitley Strieber, and this is Dreamland. You've reached the edge of the world.
Well, good morning, afternoon, or evening, wherever you are. You have found Dreamland, you lucky soul. I'm Whitley Strieber. Today we're going to be talking with a remarkable man, the Reverend Gregory Kehn. But before we start, I want to play for you a mysterious audio clip. And then I'm going to start talking with Greg about it. This is from a session that I did with Greg back in the late 90s, I think about 1996 or 1997, at the Lilydale Assembly in his house there. Ann and I were there, and we had booked a psychic reading with Gregory. And during that reading, the single most astonishing psychic hit in my long life of getting psychic readings and so forth occurred. Listen up.
The other energies are this. You had a circumstance in a car that your car cut out, and then it wouldn't start for a moment, and you started to back up and it worked.
That just happened about 3 weeks ago, yes.
They were preventing you from being somewhere at the time span prescribed, because I feel there were some people going to tag or meet you or follow you, and that they disrupted it, and they didn't know where you were at or what you were doing.
Because it was just a moment that it happened, and it was so strange, because It's never happened before or since.
It won't happen again.
The visitors did that? The
Yes. Visitors
did that to prevent me from meeting somebody they didn't want me to meet?
Right.
Wow.
That would have been disruptive to you.
Because that was such a... strange little incident. I didn't understand it at all when it happened.
That was my reading with Greg Kehn, and I, at the time, was blown away by it. And I'll tell you why, but first I want to introduce the Reverend Gregory Kehn. I'm so happy to have you on the show, Greg. It is a real honor. Thank you for coming.
Thank you. Thank you for having me on. It's wonderful.
Well, good. I hope you'll enjoy it. And we always have a lot of fun on Dreamland. It's not a light show exactly, but it's a show for explorers. And you don't jump down the throats of people who are doing insane and wild things and have extraordinary careers at the edge of reality. And if I could describe anyone as having an extraordinary career at the edge of reality, it's you. Now, let's first talk about the audio clip that we just heard. Let me set the scene, folks. Ann and I, about a couple of years before I had that reading, we're driving in a new Volvo toward the New York State Thruway from Putnam County, New York, on a road that tees in directly into it. And we were within sight of the toll booth, which was just not even a mile away from the car, when the car suddenly died. I mean, all the red lights went on, the power steering went out, and I had to struggle it over to the roadside. There was no explanation for it at all. And we just sat there. It didn't turn on. The key didn't work. Nothing worked. Then on its own, a few minutes later, it just turned on again. And we went on up to New York State Thruway, drove to the New Paltz, New York exit, and then from there drove to our cabin about 5 or 6 miles from there and thought no more of it. A couple of years pass. We're up in Chautauqua, the Chautauqua Institution in Western New York State. We used to go there every summer. We loved it. And we would always spend some time at the Spiritualist Church of America's camp, the Lilydale Assembly. And someone at Chautauqua had said, well, the Reverend Gregory Kehn is one of the psychics you must not miss. He is really something. Well, I found out that was true. Because during my reading, he suddenly started talking about that car incident, as you heard. What are the odds? It was unbelievable, but here's the thing. He said we had been served saved from someone who was trying to kill us when it wanted to. And in those days, still communion was a big, big deal in the world. It still is, oddly enough. But at the time, there were loads of people, and we had to be very careful because there were a lot of people who were quite hostile to us. And I think our guardian angel, I guess, saved our lives. And so that was what Ann and I decided. Then, a few days later, still at Lilydale, our son shows up. And we tell him the story. And we say to him, I think we have a guardian angel. I think the guardian angel stopped the car. At that moment, same car stopped again, same way. And then a few seconds later, it started up. So this is sort of a show about a guardian angel and someone who uncovered the secret of our guardian angel's presence in our lives. Greg, I want to start by letting you give us a little bit. Gregory is a medium. And can you tell us a little bit about what it takes to become a medium in the Spiritualist Church of America?
Well, in Lilydale, there's a 2-year testing period. If someone was to be registered there, there's a 2-year testing period. And you also have the ministry. I taught for Fellowship of the Spirit for 46 years. And I taught mediumship and healing and part of the ministry also. So as a child, I started giving messages at Lilydale when I was 8 years old.
When you were eight?
There was some 8 years old, and there were some people there that were certainly much older that didn't think a child should be out there giving messages. And I had one of the older mediums on the grounds, which was a very good medium, and he had been there basically all his life. He said to me, "Don't let anyone deter you." He said, "I'm doing the service. I'm chairperson. I want you to come out and work." Well, he said to me on the pathway back from Inspiration Stump, he said, "You have some people that can't do what you do." He said, "They're much older than you." And he said, "Still can't do what you can do." And he said, "You need to trust what you're feeling and ignore anyone that's putting out any negativity in any form. Just bypass that energy and go, because your guardian angels are with you." And I know I've been protected many, many times in my life, be it in a sense of people or what they're saying or actual possibility of accidents. I mean, I know I've been protected many, many, many times. But in mediumship, I was raised by my mother, my grandmother, my father, and all of them had mediumistic abilities. And going back in Lilydale, I find relatives back in 1896 that were mediums in Lilydale, singers in Lilydale, music writers, book writers, on the board there, worked in the Healing Temple. So in 1896, I had relatives there. And all the way up from there, I've had relatives that have connected in Lilydale. Now, I didn't know that when I was a child. I only knew about 4 generations. But I find it fascinating that once I was a little bit older, I started recognizing the connections and how I was connecting with spirit. Because my teachers and guides always said to me on the earth plane, the ones in the living, always said to me, "Do not limit yourself by our own restriction or fear of, can I do it? Know that you can do it. Know that you can take and trust spirit, and that integrity is something spirit will carry through." And I find that when we're in our conscious mind and we're thinking in a conscious physical world level, we can muck it up. But if we're listening to spirit and we let that purity of guidance come through, we may not on the earth plane have the supports of it in a conscious way to say those things are valid or would work. But in reality, they always work. And I find people that are mediums, they're having a difficult time at times separating themselves from their own conscious restrictions to the idea of trusting what Spirit's giving you.
You know, that's very important, folks. It's very important to me personally, because I have a lot of mediumistic hits all the time. Only if I sit down with someone, I immediately kind of clam up because I'm afraid I'll make a mistake. And it's wise advice. You know, maybe I should go up to Lilith Hill and take a course in mediumship maybe this summer. That's not a bad idea, because I'm personally very close to it. And
yes.
I've had also a lot of, when I have a mediumship session, it's often very good. In other words, there's something about the sitter that helps too, I think.
Is oh, absolutely.
Good? Tell us about what's a good sitter and a bad sitter.
Well, a good sitter is allowing themselves to be open and not be demanding of certain particular subjects or a focus of one thing. I'll explain it this way. I have quite a few clients that I've read for years and years. You know, last summer I had a lady that came into the Dale and I read for her, and she said to me, she says, "Well, I want you to know you've read for five generations of my family now."
My goodness.
And I thought it was quite interesting. And she said, "Well, you've read for me for 47 years now."
And so, do you know these people? Do you remember them when you see them? Or is it that you're in trance and you don't?
There's times I remember them. And I notice it at times. It'll be a recognition of vibration. And I'll connect with them. Like if they're in the auditorium and I'd read for them years ago, there's times in the auditorium when you're going and just giving messages randomly. There are times it'll just come to me that it's like, I already know them. It's like that feeling comes through from Spirit that you already know them. And it's a very comfortable, very easy energy to work with because there's already been a link. And I think those links connect and last, and whether we're consciously aware of them or not. I don't think it matters that we're consciously connecting it as much as it is spiritually connecting it.
I think it must matter a great deal if you're spiritually connecting it. Well, listen, Free Side, we are going to take a brief break. My new book, Jesus, A New Vision, is not a Christian book. It is not an anti-Christian book either. Very much not an anti-Christian book. It is new, genuinely new, a look at Jesus in his life and what happened afterwards, his resurrection. For the Shroud of Turin is no medieval forgery. It goes all the way back, and it does record an extraordinary event that appears to have been a body transforming into a form of coherent light. The science is very strong at this point. And yet, how could that be? What an extraordinary mystery. The life of Jesus is mysterious indeed, but the greater part of the mystery is about us. How is it that a human body could transform in that way? Who accomplished it? Why did it happen? What does it mean to you and me about our lives now? Jesus, A New Vision, a new window into a very old way of looking at the truth. A way of finding ourselves, perhaps, that we lost a long time ago, but can recover. Jesus, A New Vision is available in Kindle format, as a paperback, in audiobook format on Audible and Apple, and as a Kindle and paperback on Amazon. Do go and get it today. Where is the unknown country?
Is it out there in the stars? Or is it also somewhere else? Is it in us, in you? Unknown country, join us today. Go to unknowncountry.com right now and join us. Join the questions. Join the search. Join the adventure. Unknowncountry.com. There's no place like it in the world.
This is Whitley Strieber on Dreamland. We're talking to the Reverend Gregory Kehn. He is a medium with the Spiritualist Church of America who practices at the Lilydale Assembly in Western New York State in the summer, and you practice at home in the winter in Florida, is that?
Yes, we're in Ocala, Florida, and I practice here all the time in person on video and, you know, on the phone.
So you can, in other words, you can get in touch with Greg by calling the number that's now scrolling across the screen. And for those of you on audio only, it's 716-595-3529. And I might add that we don't have any commercial connection whatsoever. This isn't this show doesn't work that way. It's not an infomercial. So if you want to explore getting a session with Greg, 716-595-3529. Now, let's go back to your childhood, and you come from a family of mediums. Is this?
Yes.
Yes. But something happened to you that was not usual, involving an illness, I believe.
At 11 years old, I had an infection in my chest and lungs. And I was in really bad shape, and the doctors thought they were going to lose me. And in a week's time span, I lost 26 pounds. I had 106 temperature, and I stepped out of the body, actually passed over three times. And I refer to it now as astrally stepping out, because when I stepped out of the body, my grandmother had passed when I was 9. And when I was 11 is when I had this event occur. And my mother, being a medium, she understood. And she said, you're going to get through this. This is for you to learn and experience. And the three times it happened in a week, I had lost a lot of weight. And the first time it happened, they thought for sure I was gone. And in essence, I was. And I went over to the spirit side through the tunnel of light and experienced standing along a river. And what was a bit odd, Whitley, was, you know how in a car, if you step on the gas, you feel you're speeding up.
Yes.
You step on the brake and you're slowing down and you'll feel that surge in your body. I was moving what to me was like light speed through this tunnel. And I didn't feel a surge in a sense of speeding up. I didn't feel a surge in a sense of slowing down. And when I come out of the tunnel, I was standing by a river. As I'm standing there, I didn't feel out of balance. I didn't feel like I had the brakes on to slow down. And I'm standing right by this river, and I'm watching the tunnel dissipate and disappear to my left. And it just faded away. And then I heard my name called, which I recognized my grandmother's voice. And she was calling me. She said, Gregory, come here. She was on the other side of the river. And as I'm standing there, there's a part of my mind was saying, you know, you can't get to the other side. There's no bridge. And she said to me, Gregory, come here. And I knew within me that I could walk across the river. And as I'm walking across the river, I know I wasn't even getting my ankles wet. It's like I was just walking across like it was a floor. And I got to the shore on the other side. And I went over to her and she gave me a hug and she said, "You need to know now you're not staying. You're going to go back. But we have some people for you to meet and you have some things you need to learn." And she introduced me to Jesus, and Jesus was standing there and clasped both of my hands together and said, "You have a purpose in life that you're needing to understand." And as he worked with me, it's like somewhat of a mental telepathy of all this information was pouring into my mind. And I was so aware of so many things. And you know how you see at the bottom of a news, you see the ticker tape across the bottom?
Yes.
I was watching one now. Something similar to that. And it was amazing because as I'm watching it, it's pictures. No sound, no, you know, voice, just pictures. But it was pictures of events of what was coming in the world. And all the different events, you know, tidal waves and earthquakes and Mount St. Helens and all these things that were happening, floods. I was being shown all these things in pictures. And as Jesus was expressing to me what I was here for in the body, I was so interested in all the people behind my grandmother, and everyone that was over there had passed before my conception. And I started getting messages from them. And my dad's father came through and gave me some very, very important messages for my father and my grandmother, for my mother. Different ones stepped in that I would have never known in the physical world, but they were giving me information. And I was already thinking at that time, it's like, how can I remember all this? And I remembered it. It was all there, but it was like amazing to me that there was just so much given to me so quickly and so in depth. And I remember getting back the first time, coming back to the body, and I woke up with this jolt. And my mother said, "You're okay. You're all right." And I started just spewing all these things at the Jesus was telling me, what my grandmother told me, what other people were telling me. And I scared my father. He was leaning over me and he turned sheet white. And he was hanging on the side of the bed and he walked out of the room. And my mother patted me on the chest and she said, "Gregory, you're okay." She said, "Just remember everything. Make sure you remember everything." She went out in the hallway and got him back in the room. And she said to him, and I heard them when they opened the door, she said, "Jane, just shut up and listen to everything he says. Don't question anything." And he came and stood by the bed again. And I immediately started back into Father's messages and all the things that came through. Well, that happened 3 times in a week. And each time it was more and more and more information about what was going to be happening in the world and the different events. So as a child, I was quite amazed at all that and what purpose I had, what, in a sense, messages that I need to be here for to share with others. And that was such an important factor in my life that that happened 3 different times. And it seemed to me like a long span of time of being over there and communicating things. But my mother said it wasn't on the earth plane side. It wasn't that long. So
interesting.
It was like the time was somehow diverted and the expanded time over there was brought back and put in a relatively short period of time on the earth plane.
I felt like
I talked to him for a long time.
I've heard that before from other near-death experiencers. Elizabeth Crone, who was struck by lightning and killed, but had an NDE lasted 2 weeks on the other side. But when mm-hmm. she came back, she'd only been dead for about 20 minutes, I believe. So mm-hmm. that's not uncommon. I don't want to get into a discussion of how time works, goodness knows, because we won't get anywhere. I can already assure you of that. But it's interesting that that's not an uncommon experience. Tell us a little bit about what happened. I mean, what were the messages? And have some of them come true, or are they all still sort of waiting in the wings?
Well, I've had everything happening. I know there's more to come, but I had, the Vietnam War, Mount St. Helen. I mean, the first space shuttle that went up and exploded. I had a circle in my house for 20 years in Ohio, and I had the same people sitting in the circle for that period of time. And we didn't let people in. We had the same group. If they couldn't make it, it was an empty chair. And before the space shuttle went up, that rocket went up, I felt with spirit that they were explaining to me that launch was doomed. And I said to the people in the circle, I said, let's pray for them and pray for the highest and best outcome. And here, that's the rocket that went up that had the dark-haired school teacher on it, and it exploded. And we're praying for them ahead of time before the launch occurred. And when the launch occurred, I was watching it. And friends of mine were in the living room with me. And I said to them, I said, we need to send energy to them and pray for them. And we were sending energy to them and watched the rocket go up and explode. And at that time, the news people were saying that, they died in the explosion. And it wasn't brought out until later that the oxygen was on fire in the capsule. And
oh my.
That was something that came to me, and I shared that at that time with the group I was sitting with. And everyone was very taken back by the whole event. But later on, they finally admitted things as to what actually occurred. But that was just such a shame because I felt it. But I also have had other things happen in my life where if I'd have called them up and said, hey, this is going to happen, they'd have probably come with the white jackets and put me away.
Yeah. Yeah, I know the feeling. I've had other mediums who've had that experience and have tried to do it and gotten put away. So you're
yes.
right. Absolutely.
And I was told by spirit that it was a destiny, and it was something that I wasn't needed to attempt to change it. It would only cause a great deal of turmoil in my life. And to accept it as a destiny and to pray for them.
Now, this is an interesting, we're going to take a little break. And when we come back, we're going to talk to Greg about the ability to change things that haven't happened yet and how real that is and what it all means. We'll be right back.
UnknownCountry.com subscribers have access to a vast treasury of information. Listen to what Dr. Robert Schock said. He's an expert on the past, and for that reason, he also knows a great deal about the future.
We are re-entering, as you say, a debris field, and when you have a debris field like this, it enters the solar system, it energizes the solar system as you have things going into the sun, even clouds of dust particles, for instance, it will energize the sun, it will destabilize the sun. This is what we saw at the end of the last ice age in approximate terms, about 13,000 years ago.
And just in the past few days, more enormous meteors have been sighted. And this goes on continuously, more and more every year. We live in a time of great change in a world that doesn't like to look at things as they are. UnknownCountry.com offers extraordinary information, a vast archive that you cannot find anywhere else. Subscribe today. Help keep this website going, because without you, there is and can be no us. Go to unknowncountry.com right now. Click on the subscribe tab. Get started. Have you ever read Communion? Or have you never read Communion? It's out in a new edition. Very powerful, a subtly new cover that reflects the fact that the visitors are now looking back at us, because they truly are. You can get it from the unknowncountry.com store as a Kindle, as a beautiful, sumptuous paperback, or as an unabridged audiobook read by me. It's the first time in the whole life of Communion that it has been read in full in audio format, and believe you me, I felt that reading. I put my life, my memories, into it, and I trust you can hear it in the voice. I sure felt it while I was reading. So get Communion, listen to it, read it. Communion is of central importance to all of our lives.
We're talking to the Reverend Gregory Kehn. You can reach him on his website, Gregory Kehn, Reverend Gregory Kehn. I'm just going to run the clip. It's much easier. ReverendGregoryKehn.com. You can call him for a session at 716-595-3529. And you could make an appointment with him in the Lilydale Assembly, which is a beautiful summer home of the Spiritualist Church of America, one of my favorite places in the world. I spoke there last summer, and it was such an absolute delight. I was just a joy to be there. And so now let's go ahead and go on. When you are, can you intervene with something that hasn't happened yet?
I feel we can intervene with the thought and the prayer and putting out energy for it. And I find that what it really comes down to is, are the souls involved in the circumstances occurring, are they open to the transition of change and acceptance of what we're needing to learn? If we're allowing ourselves to really be open to what we're learning, we can divert things and change things in a positive way. And I see some things that I would term destiny that are certainly, it's the way it's going to happen, you know, no matter what. But I've had events happen where Spirit said to me, with the right awareness and change, you know, my grandmother used to say to me, do we make a speed bump or do we make a mountain? And if we can do a speed bump, we learn and accept things and accept the changes we resist. If we do the mountain, we're climbing the mountain and it's a major lesson and it's going to be tough. And it's our choice as to whether we bring harmony or disharmony to our lessons of advancement. Because I believe all of us have the ability to bring positive energy to whatever event or circumstance is occurring. And I feel like you were saying ahead of time, I've had different events come to me. Now, for example, your event with the car and it stopped. I've had it happen where it's come to me in a dream of what the surroundings were of a certain event, and I could avoid the event. And I could not have to go through the severity of what could possibly occur. And it was my understanding and acceptance that changed it. In other words, we learn our lesson by acceptance instead of learning our lessons the hard way.
So I want to get in a little bit to the lessons and spiritual development classes before we go ahead. I keep meaning to do this, and this happens at Lilydale. Is that correct?
Yes. Yeah, okay. We have a lot of classes at Lloydell all summer, and it's a 10-week season, and you can go to Lloydell Assembly, and on the website, and it shows everything there that you have classes and seminars. You also have a list of mediums there that if you choose to go to a certain person for readings, I would always advise everyone to set an appointment.
Yeah.
We have literally thousands of people come there through the summer.
Yeah, I noticed that. It's very important to set an appointment if you're going to go to Lilydale, folks. And how do you give us some advice about if, say, someone is coming to the Lilydale Assembly for the first time and would like to visit a medium and has no information, aside from visiting you, what would they do to decide on which medium they might want?
Well, I would certainly suggest going to their websites. There's a website in the catalog for Lloydell. When you go to the website and you see all the mediums, and you can go to each medium and see what their website has to say and what you're drawn to. You know, I find that people that go, I had a lady come on my porch one time. Her husband did not have an appointment, but she had an appointment with me. And I read for her and finished, and he was on the porch. And he said, well, do you have time for another one? And I said, no, I got someone else that is already appointed time. He said, well, it's like an oil change. He said, I'll just go, and whoever's open, I'm going to go to. Well, his wife came back to me later, and she said, we're going to call you on the phone and set an appointment for his reading. And I said, well, he wasn't real keen on the idea of getting a reading anyhow. I said, his approach to it or his thought about it. And she goes, he figured that one out. So okay. I had to laugh a little bit, because I find that if you're drawn to someone, there's a magnetism there that really says this is who you need to go to. And even if you're looking at the list of mediums on the board at Lloydell, on the building there at the auditorium, you can look at the list and who stands out that you're very drawn to. And especially if you're going to be going to Lloydell, if you go ahead and you look at the websites, I'm sure you'll find someone you feel harmony with, and there's others you may not feel that depth of harmony with. And also we have the outdoor services. We have the auditorium service 2:30 every day, and their medium's working. And we have the outdoor service inspiration stump, which is out in the woods, and we have a big seating area out there for everyone. And that's at that would be at 1 o'clock and 5:30 every day. And then at Forest Temple, every day but Sunday, we have an outdoor service up there. And it's a series of mediums that'll come up and work and share messages, usually 2-3 messages each. And then you change message ministers. So see who you're drawn to. I find most of the time, I don't really have people coming to me until they're drawn to me. I very, very seldom have someone show up on the porch and say, do you, you know, have a cancellation? It's like, I find the energy is so really strong and in depth when you feel something for that particular person.
I understand. Because, you know, that's how it happened with us. We were at Chautauqua, and we asked around because we wanted to go to Lilydale. My wife was very sensitive to this sort of thing, and she definitely wanted to go there. And she said, well, I said, how do we choose a medium? And she said, it won't be hard. I'll choose the medium. We were talking about mediums with some people who went there often. And your name came up, and Annie said, we'll be going to Greg Kehn. And that's how we did it.
Yeah.
And again, that extraordinary thing happened. And there was a lot of other things in the reading too, folks, by the way, about my career, which was going on at the time, and they were quite accurate. Now, I would like to know that, I mean, about books I was publishing and whether or not they would be published and ideas I was thinking. It was a really strong connection. But I would like to know this. One of the things about the Spiritualist Church of America that I thought was very impressive is the test that is needed in order to gain the the honorific of Reverend as a medium. Can you tell us about how mediums are tested at Lilydale?
Well, we have a testing in spring and fall, and you have 2 years of going and working the outdoor services, being in the auditorium and working. You have Monday night circles. And what happens is the mediums that are already there and are already certified registered mediums there are then keeping notes on how someone works, how well have they worked, how accurate are they. And there's a whole procedure of documentation. And then you get to the point after the two-year program, you then have the opportunity to actually test. And we have people that are going to be people you read for. And they then score you. And they score you on how well you've done, how well you've presented. Here's the accuracy of what you've given. And that's been done in, you know, for forever and years. And I find that that weeds out a lot of people that either aren't really in tune the way they need to be, or they're trying too hard in a conscious way, because working with people and being certified in Lilydale, there's quite a process.
Yeah, and, so I've heard. That's why I asked.
And the process for me when I was there as a child, when I was ordained in a spiritualist church in 1980, and I was ordained in two groups, because the one group I had been with since being a teenager, and a lot of them were so much older and they were passing over. And I was invited to another group, and I went to that group, IGAS, International General Assembly Spiritualists. And I've been a minister in that group for years. So I look at the energy there. Now you have different schools. You have different teachings that you can become a minister in a spiritualist church. But that's the spiritualist churches individually. And then when you come to Lilydale, that's a separate entity. And you have to be, for example, being on the grounds, to own a home on the grounds, to be a member on the grounds. You go before the board. You had to have been a spiritualist church member for at least a year, if not 2 years. I forget now exactly how they worked that out, whether it was 1 year or 2 years. And then to be certified as a medium, you have to do the two-year program. So it's something that it's really quite in depth and a lot of commitment.
Yeah, and so the people who are mediums on the grounds have gone through a process where it has been essentially proved that they can do it.
Yes.
That's the thing that surprised me, because when I first heard about it, Anne was very interested in it. And of course, I thought, oh, my, a bunch of mediums all collected together in the same place. That's going to be a gas. but she guided me to it very well. And she said, they are not a bunch of idiots, Whitley. And look at what has happened to you. And you're considered, widely considered, much more of an idiot than any medium in this country. So we're going. and I learned that this is real. And now I know, among other things, a very private physical medium who's, I'm not going to name him. Can definitely and visibly, without using any trickery, affect things in the physical world very profoundly. And I wanted to get to that. What do you, you're not a physical medium. In other words, you're not having the horns fly up in the air or anything like that.
I've sit in many of those circles where we had trumpets in the air and we've had materialization. And my main teacher, Dana Bailey, was a trance medium. And I worked with him from about 7.5, 8 years old on up until he passed. And he was passing in his 80s. And I grew up around him. And it was, you know, he put his wing over me when I was just a young child. And he said to me and my mother, he said, "This young man has the ability, and I would love to guide him and work with him in it." And I've spent a good part of my life around him, and he was an amazing man. And the things he could do, I've sat in circles where we had materialization, where the materialized entity came over and took me by my arms and pulled me out of my chair.
That happens. That's not the only case of that happening. What was it like?
Well, it was really interesting because it was one of my Indians that is a guide to me. And he took me by the forearm, and literally I could feel the pressure pulling me out of the chair. And I stood up and he said, "I want to show everyone this, and I give you permission to reach through me." And he said, "Do not hesitate, reach through me." And I put my hand against him, and it was like pushing my hand through cool, wet jello.
My God.
And as my hand come out of the other side, I mean, I'm 6'3", and I have fairly long arms. It come out of the other side of him, and I turned my hand, and people on the other side were responding to the fact that, you know, my hand was there. They could see my hand.
They must have been responding, I would think.
And one poor lady was ready to run out of the room, and they held her in her seat for a bit to calm her down. And I pulled my hand back out, and that cool jello feeling lasted for hours. And he said to me, he said, "I want everyone here to know how real this is. I am here with you." And he even explained, below the knee, he had no leg going down to the foot, because he wanted to prove that this was not somebody dressed up, you know, coming out in a human form. And he stood there and he bowed. He turned to the rest of the room, bowed to me again, and he disappeared through the cement floor.
Do they live somewhere that we can't reach in this state, or are they in a non-physical state most of the time, do you think?
Well, I think they're in a non-physical state most of the time. And my teacher was a trance medium, and I sat with him many, many, many times when he was in trance. And we had certain mediums at that time that we knew that were materialization mediums, trumpet mediums. You know, I've had a couple stones that were brought through the trumpet to me. And they were so hot that I had to keep switching hands with them. That was so hot when it came out of the trumpet.
I was once in a session. Oh, free Dreamlanders, I have to say goodbye. We'll see you again next week.
You've been listening to Dreamland. Be sure to tune in again next week. Dreamland is brought to you by unknowncountry.com and its family of subscribers. Our theme music is The O of Pleasure by Ray Lynch. Unknown Country was founded by Ann Strieber. Our news editor is Matthew Frizzell. Our coordinator is Amy Safrankova. Whitley Strieber is your Dreamland host. And I'm your announcer, Ted Alexander.